the 6, and let me turn it here as well. Matthew chapter 22. Let us stand for the reading of God's word. Amen. Amen. Matthew chapter 22. And we're going to start at verse 1. If you don't have your Bibles, it is on the screen as well, the scripture from the New King James Version of the Bible. Amen. And it reads as follows from Matthew chapter 22, verse 41 through 46. It reads as follows. While the Pharisees were gathered together, Jesus asked them, saying, "What do you think about the Christ? Whose son is he?" And they said to him, "The son of David." He said to them, "How then does David in the Spirit call him Lord, saying, 'The Lord said to my Lord, sit at my right hand till I make your enemies your footstool.' If David then calls him Lord, how is he his son?" Verse 46, "And no one was able to answer him a word, nor from that day on did anyone dare question him anymore." Amen. You may be seated. Amen. Amen. Just for a few minutes, I'd like to use as a subject or theme today, don't walk away from God's grace. Amen. Don't walk away from God's grace. Let us bow our heads for a word of prayer. Father, in the name of Jesus, we come to you as humble as we know how, giving your name the praise and honor and glory for everything that you have done for us. Heavenly Father, we ask that you open up our spiritual understanding, that we may begin to let your word make a mark upon us that will never ever be erased. Heavenly Father, I must decrease and you must increase. Lord, if somebody is here today who does not know Jesus Christ as their Savior, Heavenly Father, after hearing your gospel, Father, prick their hearts according to your will, that they may say, "What must I do to be saved?" In Jesus' name, amen. Don't walk away from God's grace. Listen, I'm not going to be before you long, so come on in as we begin to understand God's word this morning. From Matthew. As you can see the sign behind us, it says Passion Week. Listen, what is Passion Week? Some of you may want to know. Well, Passion Week is really the final week of Jesus Christ before he went to the cross. As a matter of fact, it covers the cross. It covers from that Monday, even Sunday, from that Sunday all the way to his resurrection. A whole week, 7 days, the last days before Jesus went to the cross. So last year we started this series called Passion Week, and we went through Monday, and then we went through Tuesday. On Monday, Sunday night, Jesus stayed over with his friend's house, Mary and Martha's house, rolled in on the donkey. Some say Sunday, but it can be proven it could have been Monday as well. Then on Tuesday, Jesus was on his way to the temple, and he cursed a fig tree. Remember that? When he first cursed the fig tree on his way to the temple. And then Jesus went into the temple and whipped everyone who was selling in the temple. Then on the way back, Jesus, not only after he cursed the fig tree because he wanted something to eat, he remembered as well that the tree was cursed. That was on Tuesday. Then on Wednesday, Jesus began to teach, and that's where we are now. We're at the teachings of Jesus Christ on Wednesday. Wednesday is a long day. It's going to be a lot of teaching going on, so we will never ever finish this Passion Week on this year, but we're going to still stay with Wednesday. So on Wednesday, this passage that you're reading right now happened on a Wednesday, 2 days before Jesus died on the cross, and that is Matthew 22, verse 41 through 46. This is a message about how to enter into the kingdom of God by answering one question. And if you can answer this question, then you'll know how to enter the kingdom of God. And that question is, as the verse says, whose son is Christ? So when we understand this answer to this question, whose son is Christ, then you'll know how to enter into the kingdom of God. Then you'll know what grace is all about. So we know, once again, that it is Wednesday. Jesus is teaching in the temple, and they asked Jesus several questions at this time. But guess what? Now it's Jesus' turn to ask the question. It's Jesus' turn to turn the questions around to them. And just like a parent with small children, Jesus is going to graciously show the Old Testament connection of how Jesus is the Christ. So let's go. Let's I only have 4 points. Let's look at point number one. The Messiah. How do we know who the Messiah is? The Messiah is David's physical son. If you have some paper, write this down. The Messiah is David's physical son. Let's look at verse 41 and 42. Let's see this. Who is the Messiah? Verse 41 and verse 42 says this. While the Pharisees were gathered together, Jesus asked them, saying, "What do you think about the Christ? Whose son is he?" And they said to him, "The son of David." Stop right there. He said, "What say ye? How do you think of the Christ?" Now watch this. When he asked about the Christ, I don't know if you remember when Jesus asked the disciples one day. He says, "Whom do men say that I am?" Right? And Jesus says, "Some think that you are Elijah. Some think that you're one of the prophets. Some think that you're this or that." And then it was Peter who said, "You are the Christ, the Son of the living God." And Jesus was the one saying, "Listen, Peter, flesh and blood did not reveal this to you, but my Father in heaven revealed this to you." But I want you to notice a difference. Jesus, in that particular situation, he asked them a question, right? He asked them, who do men say that I am? And this question, he's not talking to the disciples, he's talking to the Pharisees, and he's not asking the Pharisees who he is, he's asking them this question: who is the Christ? Whose son is the Christ? Whose son is the Messiah? Now, if these men who call themselves scholars really wanted to think about it, they thought they knew everything about the Christ. They thought, these Pharisees and Sadducees thought they knew everything about the Messiah himself. Well, let me give you a scripture to find out whose son he is physically. He's David's physical son. And the proof that I have that he comes from David's physical lineage is Isaiah chapter 11, verse 1. And it says this: "There shall come forth a rod from the stem of Jesse, and a branch shall grow out of his roots." So in other words, what he's telling you is this. He's saying this, that the Messiah himself, the Savior of the world, comes from the line of David. And if you don't remember, who was David? David, King David, the one God anointed king to be over Israel, the one God told him, said, "Listen, you're going to have a son that's going to come from your lineage, David, and he's going to sit on the throne, and when he sits on the throne, he'll never lose the throne. He's going to sit on the throne forever and ever and ever." And he's saying here in this passage that that son comes from David. Yeah. Somebody say amen. 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 Point number two. Let's go to point number two. Not only is he son of David, point number two, David calls his son Lord. David called his son Lord. Look at verse 43 and 44. It says this in verse 43 and 44, how David called his son Lord. And he said to them, "How then does David in the spirit call him Lord, saying, 'The Lord said to my Lord, sit at my right hand till I make your enemies your footstool.'" Now, what is he talking about here when he said that? Listen, when he says David calls him Lord, "Sit at my right hand till I make your enemies your footstool." Now, here is where it gets interesting. We're trying to understand what grace is about. We're trying to understand who the Messiah is. So here's where it gets interesting. Jesus, when he said, "Sit here at my right hand till I make your enemies your footstool. Jesus didn't make those words up right there. Jesus was quoting from Psalms 110. If you read Psalms 110, verse 1, you will read those words where he says, my Lord said to my Lord, sit at my right hand till I make your enemies my footstool. Now, what does that mean when he says, my Lord said to my Lord, sit at my right hand? This is a powerful psalm that is being quoted in the New Testament over 37 times. But what does it mean when he says, my Lord said to my Lord, sit at my right hand? There's a few things you need to notice before we explain that, and it's this. It is written by David. Right? And another point is this, that it comes from God. God shows us prophecy lots of time. God's word comes in prophetic meaning sometimes. And in this particular passage, God prophesies and says this through David, that he calls the Messiah Lord. Now we got to understand which Lord, because in our English language, I think I taught this in Sunday school before, when he says, my Lord says to my Lord, sit at thy right hand. So let me take you back. Now, in the word Lord, when you see the word Lord in all capitals, it refers to the original name of God. And God's name is Yahweh. I just want you to understand that. He only has one name. Everything else we call him are titles. So he has one name. And the reason they put Lord instead of Yahweh is because the Jews did not want to put the Lord's name in vain. So they came up with this title called Lord instead of saying Yahweh. That's why we say Lord all the time. But that particular Lord, the first one, when it says, my Lord, Yahweh said to my Lord. Watch this. He says, my Lord, which is Yahweh, says to my Lord. But he didn't say Yahweh in the second Lord. He used another term for Lord in the Old Testament, which is Adonai. So in other words, it says this, Yahweh said to Adonai, sit right here at my right hand. So do you understand? Because you was trying to figure out my Lord said to my Lord. Yahweh said to Adonai, sit at my right hand. The question is this, and he's going to ask that question in a minute. We're going to read it in a few seconds, why he calls him Lord. But I just wanted you to understand what that means. Watch this, point number three. God honors the one David calls Lord. God honors the one David calls Lord. So the Lord said to my Lord, Yahweh said to Adonai, sit at my right hand till I make your enemies my footstool. So what are we bringing up? We're trying to tell you this, that in the Old Testament, it is actually teaching that the Messiah, because remember, Jesus hasn't revealed himself to the Pharisees yet that he's talking about himself. He just said, who is the Messiah? And whose son is he? And they said, he is David's son, right? And he said, so if he's David's son, how come David is calling his son Lord? How come he's calling his son Lord or Adonai? So you still may be a little lost, so let me take you a little further. When you say the word Yahweh, we know that's talking about God, but there is another term that refers to God only, and it is Adonai. So when you say Adonai in the Old Testament, that name Adonai only refers to God. There is no other term that refers to God when you say Lord is other than Adonai and Yahweh. So now let's go back to Psalms 110 again. My God said to my God, sit at my right hand. Now you say, I'm lost now. How are you going to say my God said to my God? So what is he teaching? He's teaching that the Son is God. He's teaching when he says, Yahweh said to my God.
Yeah.
Yahweh, who is God, said to my God, Jesus, or the Messiah, what? Sit right here on my right hand.
Yeah.
So for those who wouldn't believe that Jesus is God or the Messiah is God, I have just proven to you from Psalms 110 that passage is a messianic passage that says this, that the Messiah is God. That's what Jesus wanted them to see, right? Jesus wanted these Pharisees to see. That's why he asked the question. He asked the question, whose son is he? The only answer part that they knew is that he come from David. But when Jesus threw this other question, well, why is David calling his so-called son God? They were quiet. They had no answer for him. And Jesus is actually teaching this when he says in Psalms 110 and verse 1, sit here at my right hand, is that the person that sits on the right hand of God is God himself. He is Jesus the Christ, the second person of the Godhead. So let's explain this real quick to you, that God is one God. We serve one God. But God is manifested through three persons. He's manifested through the Father, through the Son, and through the Holy Ghost. Don't let nobody tell you that you serve three gods. You don't serve three gods, you serve one, right? One God who manifests himself through three persons. So God the Father is God, God the Son is God, and God the Holy Spirit is God. Well, how is it that they are not three gods? Well, the same essence that flows through the Father flows through the Son. And the same essence that flows through the Son flows through the Holy Spirit. Now, my point is this. The essence that flows through the Father never was created. It doesn't have a beginning, and it doesn't have an end. The same essence that flows in the Son never had a beginning, never had an end. The essence that flows through the Holy Spirit never had a beginning, nor an end. Nobody created the Father. Nobody created the Son. Nobody created the Holy Spirit. They all existed at the same time from the beginning. So we call it the Trinity, which is not in the Bible, but the Bible does say Godhead. So watch this. Jesus wanted them to see that it was the Messiah who's going to save them, because the Jews felt that the reason the Messiah was coming, he was only coming to Israel, he was only coming to deliver them from the Roman Empire. They taught that the Messiah was only coming to free them of all of their pain and set up his kingdom and be a king for them. But Jesus is teaching here when he says, whose son is he? Jesus came down from heaven not just to be their king, but to be their savior. Not just to be their savior from the Roman Empire, but to be their savior from sin, to be their savior from hell, to be their savior from every bad thing that they ever thought. Isn't God good that he sent his only begotten son to come down in the world to free you, not from your oppressor, to free you, not from you walking up and down saying Black Lives Matter. He came down for more than that. He came down more for your marches. He came more down for that. See, we love to fight for the wrong reason. We love to stand up for something that ain't gonna last forever. If you want to fight for something, you need to stand up and say, Jesus came and set us all free. He came and delivered all of us from our sin and from our shame. Amen? Somebody needs to say amen. Jesus said this. Jesus makes this claim for himself during his trial when he said this. When Jesus talked about the right hand, notice what Jesus said. He was on his trial day and they was about to execute him 2 days from now. And Jesus said this in Matthew 26, verse 64. He said, it is as you said. Because they asked him, are you a king? And Jesus said, it is as you said. Nevertheless, I say to you, hereafter you will see the Son of Man sitting at the right hand of the power and coming on the clouds of heaven. And that's what Jesus said about himself. So I'm going to connect to you that the Messiah of the Old Testament showed up in the New Testament through Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Jesus is the only Messiah that you should be looking for.
Yeah.
Well, why would I say that? Because nowadays there are a lot of people walking around saying that they're the Messiah. Yes, there's a lot of people, even when David Koresh and the Heaven's Gates Ministry and all these people were looking for their own Messiah. As a matter of fact, is in Islam today, they call their Messiah, and this is how you say Messiah in Arabic, is Mahdi. So they're looking for their Messiah. But I'm here to tell you that the Messiah already came. And it was Farrakhan who said that the Messiah is going to come in the form of Elijah Muhammad. He thought Elijah Muhammad was the Messiah. But I'm here to tell you that the Messiah is Jesus Christ. Jesus is the only one that fits this description. It's not in Islam. It's not in Buddhism. It's not in Hinduism. It's not in any other religion. If anybody tell you that the Messiah has not come, you say, I don't know what Bible you're reading because Jesus already came. He is the Messiah. Don't let nobody pull you away from the fact that you have already been saved at the cross 2,000 years ago. Jesus said this. He said this in the Bible as well when we get to Matthew 24. He says in the last days there's going to be many false prophets. And many are going to call themselves the Christ. They're going to try to claim my title. And Jesus said you got to stay away from people like that. So Psalms 110 not only declared that Jesus is the Messiah, but he's a little more than just a human being. He's God. This is something that you really need to understand about Christianity. This separates us from everybody in the world. We are the only group of people that believe that God became a man. I'm telling you that right now. We're the only ones that believe that. Islam don't believe that Jesus is God. The Buddhists don't believe that Jesus is God. Christianity is the only one that separates us from everybody else, that you can't save yourself, only God can. We're the only ones to tell you that you can be good all you want to, but it's not good enough. We're the only ones to tell you that I don't care how much money you give to the church, that's not going to get you into heaven. I don't care how many deeds you do, it's not going to get you into heaven. We're the only ones that are going to tell you that you get to heaven by somebody else. The only way you're going to make it into the kingdom of God, you got to ride Jesus' coattail. You got to put on Jesus' righteousness. He is God wrapped up in human flesh, and that he came down to save you from your sins. I don't know if that's not rejoicing enough to make you shout that God thought of you enough to come down from his throne in heaven, wrap himself in human flesh, and die for you. It was the Muslims. The Muslims were saying, and I have talked to a couple of them. He says, you know, we can't get with Christianity. I said, why not? He said, because you believe God died. I said, yeah, we do believe that, don't we? Believe that. He said, my God don't die. I said, guess what? In the Bible, God died, but he rose on the third day. See, that was his plan. The second person of the Godhead died. See, they think that the weakness of Christianity is death. But Jesus said, no, it's by his death that he was able to deliver us from our sins. It was by the shedding of blood that caused Jesus to set us free. So even the devil thought, yeah, if we can get rid of Jesus through death, it will all be over. But Jesus says it was through death that we got the victory. Somebody need to thank God for Jesus dying for you. So he says, sit at my right hand. Yahweh said to Adonai. This only refers to him. So did you understand that if you write this verse down, and I'll read it for you, Revelations 19, verse 11 through 16 says this, and it talks about Jesus being the conquering king. He is God in the flesh. He is the savior of the world. Listen to this. It's talking about the Messiah.
Yeah.
Verse 11, Revelation 19. Then I saw heaven open, and a white horse was standing there. Its rider was named Faithful and True. for he judges fairly and wages a righteous war. His eyes were like flame of fire, and on his head were many crowns. A name was written on him that no one understood except himself. He wore a robe dipped in blood, and his title was the Word of God. The armies of heaven, dressed in the finest of pure white linen, followed him on white horses. From his mouth came a sharp sword to strike down the nations. He will rule them with an iron rod. He will release the fierce wrath of God, the Almighty, like juice flowing from a wine press. On his robe and his thigh was written this title: King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Who do you think he's talking about? He ain't talking about Farrakhan. He ain't talking about Elijah Muhammad. He ain't talking about Buddha. He's talking about Jesus Christ. There is no other man that will fit this description other than Jesus the Christ, other than the Messiah. He said he's coming back one day, and he's coming back with all power and glory. Watch this. Jesus rushes to his conclusion in verse 46. And Jesus gives this conclusion that they shouldn't doubt. No, they didn't doubt that Christ was David's son. But they didn't understand that he was God in the flesh. And look at verse 46. He says in verse 46, and no one was able to answer him a word. Nor from that day on did anyone dare question him anything. After this, because it's on Wednesday, remember, 2 days from now, he's going to die. Nobody questioned Jesus again, because they couldn't even answer the question that why did David call the Messiah his Lord? Why did he call him God? We understand why he called him God. And the scripture says he called him God by the power of the Holy Spirit, knowing that it was God himself who came down 42 generations and died on the cross for our sins. Listen, if you don't believe that Jesus is God, how can you be saved? If you don't believe that God, let's put it this way. A man can't save you. A man who's born like me and you can't save you. Anybody that's born of a man or the seed of a man, sin is in them. Did you understand that? It was passed down from Adam all the way down to us today. But there's something different about Jesus. He wasn't born of a man. He was born of a woman. So the seed of sin didn't pass down to Jesus Christ. Now watch this. Somebody said, well, wouldn't sin pass down to Jesus through Mary? Because isn't Mary a sinner? So if Jesus is in the womb of Mary, and if he's connected to her, then he has the same sinful nature as his mother. Did you notice something different in mothers in here? Correct me if I'm wrong. Did you know after a woman she's pregnant and the baby begins to grow, that the umbilical cord that feeds the baby inside the womb is not the food that the mama eats to feed the baby? As far as the blood, did you know that that child has his own blood type? Did you know that that child has its DNA of the mother and the father? Yes. So it's separated really from the mother, because it's in the sac, and right there in the sac, and it's being fed by its own bloodline. Did you know that? It's really not the food of her, but that child. God created every child this way, that the child is separated from the mother in the womb, in that sac, and being protected by him. So, yes, the sinful nature of Mary didn't pass down to Jesus, because Jesus didn't have the sinful nature of a father. So guess what? He's not like you. He's not like me. So there is no man on the planet that can tell you he can save you. There is no man on the planet that can tell you he can deliver you. It was Sun Yung-moon who said this. He's the founder of the Unification Church. He said, Jesus didn't pay the price on the cross. God gonna use my family, because my family is the family line of the Messiah. This is what Sun Yung-moon said. He has over millions and millions of followers. And he says, if my family don't die for the world, then the world won't be saved. So guess what? I'll tell you, many people out there are saying they are the Christ, and they won't believe that Jesus is the Christ. But guess what? If you walk away from God's grace, because that's what we're talking about, grace is Jesus Christ, then you won't have a place with Jesus Christ. You won't have a place with God the Father. You won't be able to go into the kingdom with Him. You won't be able to walk in heaven with Him if you don't walk in His faith. Watch this. This is my last point, last one. Not only is He the Messiah, listen, the Messiah is God in human flesh. Now, I just showed you one verse. I showed you Psalms 110. Let me give you another one. Here's another one. Write it down. Isaiah 9:6. It says this, "For a child is born to us, a son is given to us. The government will rest on his shoulders, and he will be called," watch this, "Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace." That is a messianic passage of scripture that tells you that Jesus, or the Messiah, is God. And if Jesus is the Messiah, then Jesus is God. And see, that's what we have to understand. Here's number two. Here's another one. Isaiah 53:4-5. Write that one down. "Yet it was our weakness He carried. It was our sorrows that weighed Him down. And we thought His troubles were a punishment from God, a punishment for His own sins. But He was pierced for our rebellion. He was crushed for our sins. He was beaten so we could be whole. He was whipped so we could be healed. All of us, like sheep, have strayed away. We have left God's path to follow our own. Yet the Lord laid on Him," here's that, "He laid on Him the sins of us all." So here's this perfect Jesus, this God, getting off His throne, wrapping Himself in human flesh. And guess what He did? He took your sins, He took my sins, and He placed them on Himself at the cross. And that's the greatest message in the world. I don't understand why every church should be packed. I don't understand why every church is not crowded. Understanding that we are messed up from the flow up, right? We messed up in our minds. We got all kinds of situations going on. Our kids out there in the world. We got other families in the world. People not even listening about God. We would think that we would bring everybody to somebody who can save anybody. You would think that the Christians will bring those who are messed up to somebody who can change them. The Christians will bring somebody here to hear that Jesus wiped away all of your sins. That the ones who've been saved will bring somebody else that says this, listen to this message. He saved your soul. He died for you. He shed His blood for you. We need to bring those in this place. When you tell them at your house, tell them on your job that Jesus delivered you. And why should I do that? Why should I tell them? Well, because He delivered you. Didn't Jesus wipe away your sins? Didn't Jesus clean you up? Didn't Jesus turn you around? Didn't Jesus die for you? Didn't Jesus make you whole? No, He didn't make you perfect yet, because we still live in our physical body. But didn't He say that He'll be there with you? He'll never leave you nor forsake you. Didn't He say that if you just call on Him in His name, that He'll answer your prayer? Didn't He say that if you call on the Father in His name, that He'll be right there? Well, if you've been a born again believer for a long time like I have, I called on Him when I was in trouble. I called on God through His Son when I was sick. I called on God through His Son when I was in trouble. Because guess what? I already understood that He saved my soul. He made me whole. He brought me from a mighty long way. So in my conclusion, and let me tell you this, don't walk away from God's grace. What do you mean don't walk away from God's grace? Jesus is grace. He is God's unmerited favor. We didn't have to have Jesus. He came because He wanted to. He could have left us dying. He could have left us going to hell. He could have left us messed up. But we didn't deserve Jesus, but He came anyway. We don't pray to Him, but He came anyway. We don't even read His word, but He came down 2,000 years ago anyway. We still lying, but He kept coming down over 2,000 years ago. go anyway. We still go to the clubs. We still get drunk. We still take drugs. We still cheat on our spouse. But Jesus still keep coming. He came down anyway. He knew that we was messed up. He knew that we were in sin. But he kept coming. He kept coming down 42 generations. He knew Hitler was going to kill 6 million Jews. He knew the African Americans would be in America for 400 years of slavery. But he kept coming down anyway. He knew that the terrorists would blow up this building, would blow up that building. He knew that people would kill their children. He knew that people would do all kinds of sin. But he kept coming down 42 generations because he said, I've got to die. I've got to go to the cross. Because if I can save a wretch like them, I've got to die on the cross for them. The Bible says that he came down 42 generations. Born of a virgin man, married. He grew up and at age 30 years old, he started his ministry. He only has 3 and a half years of preaching and teaching. Then he went to the cross. Guess what? He didn't go for himself. He went to the cross for me and you. Ain't God good? Ain't good that he died for you? He died for me. Guess what? Only God can do it for you. Only God can make a way out of no way. I remember growing up, and my mother used to say, I want you to clean up your room. I want you to take out the garbage can. And sometimes, you know, we would get lazy in the house, and we wouldn't do what mama said, dude. And then mama would get up. She said, guess what? If I want something done, I guess I've got to do it myself. That's what God said. He knew Abraham couldn't die for you. He knew Jacob couldn't die for you. He knew Isaac couldn't die for you. He knew Ezekiel couldn't die for you. He knew Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John couldn't die for you. He said, I'll die for them, Papa. See, they can't do it. They got sin on them. I got to go down. Get up that cross with no sin. Put sin on me. My father gonna turn his back on me. I got to do it for them. He said, my God, why have you forsaken me? He turned his back, but I got to do it for them. Jesus went to the Garden of Gethsemane and said, Father, if there's any other way, we can do this thing. Let this cup pass for me. I don't want to die. I don't want to go through the sorrow. I don't want to go through the pain. But I'll do it for them. They're not my will. Let your will be done. Don't walk away from grace. Don't walk away from the word. Don't worry about what other people are doing. Don't worry about what Trump is doing. Don't worry about what Clinton is doing. Don't worry about what the government is doing. Don't you walk away from God. Hold on now to God's unchanging hand. They can turn this country upside down. I'm not walking away from Jesus. They can keep lying on me. They can keep talking about me. But don't walk away from God's grace. Jesus is your grace. Jesus is your victory. Jesus is your deliverance. Jesus is the way out of no way. Call on him when you get in trouble. Call on him when you're sick. He will deliver you. Come on, put your hands together. Tell the Lord thank you. Tell him thank you. He's all right. He's all right. Don't walk away from God's grace. He will.
Father, we thank you once again.
for your word. Oh yes, we thank you for Jesus, teacher. He taught those Pharisees that he is the Messiah, that he is God. They couldn't even answer his question. And Heavenly Father, today we know through studying the word of God that Jesus is the Savior. He is God wrapped up in human flesh. He did die for us. He was buried for us. But he rose early Sunday morning with all power in heaven and earth in his hand. There may be somebody here who does not know Jesus Christ as their Savior. And while every head is bowed and every eye is closed, if you want Jesus to be your Savior, you want him to be your God, just raise your hand and we want you to come right now to him. Raise your hand and we'll pray with you now to accept Jesus Christ as your Savior. And second question, if you're here and you've already made that decision, you made Jesus Christ your Savior, but you don't have a church home and you've been looking for a church home and you want to come to Christian Life or Christian Experience, we will accept you now. Just raise your hand and we will ask you to come so we can actually accept you into our fold, this part of the ministry of Jesus Christ, where we can pray for you, where we can pray for resources, we can seek out what you're in need of, and we can pray for your situation. That's why we're here. We just not here for you to grow in grace, but we're also here to see if we can help you with every need that you may have. So if you need a church home, Christian Life would love to be that church home for you today. Just raise your hand where every head is bowed and every eye is closed. Amen. Let us all stand. The doors of the church is open. Amen. As we come to him. Come to Jesus. Come to Jesus.